Jenny may be more familiar to some of you than your maiden name, Jenny Shepherd, because Jenny's father was Bishop David Shepherd, who with Archbishop Derek Waller did so much in Liverpool during the 80s to heal rifts and build communities. And indeed, from the opening address that Archbishop Malcolm McMahon gave this morning, when he opened today's conference, he paid tribute to the work that the two men did in the Liverpool of the 80s. The book, Better Together, is 30 years old this year. Is that right, Jenny? Jenny met and married a Catholic, and she'll talk to you about the work that she does. But first of all, I just wondered, Jenny, could you talk a little about the work and just tell us what gave you the impetus to start your organisation?
Good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me okay? Yes. Can I hear you? Would you like to sit somewhere else? So, I started to get from Common Good about 7 years ago, and it's now a national charity. And the first idea came to me one day, which I know regards as like a prompting of the Holy Spirit. I found myself drawing a cross on the back of the book, saying social justice, ecumenism, and the intersection turned to be reconciliation. And I wondered what this was about. What was it I wanted me to think about? My mother had died the previous year, my father a few years before that, and because of the correspondence I was receiving, I was being prompted to look at the Shepherd Waller partnership properly for the first time. And when I looked at their book, I saw that the word that continued to recur was reconciliation. That was their key word. When people asked them, what is it that you're doing? They said, if we had to boil it down to one word, it's reconciliation. In a city, this city at that time was divided, sectarian divide, Catholic, Protestant, politically a basket case at the time, was led by the militants who were at war with the Thatcher government. There was no proper political leadership, high unemployment, the government was pursuing a policy of land decline, so the city was really dying away. And my father and Derek Warlock arrived around the same time, probably arranged by the Holy Spirit to come here at the same time, and they resolved to work together. So I looked at their partnership and I thought, what are the key elements from that partnership which we could use now, which we could take forward? And I recognised that they both brought different gifts to the table. One was Catholic social teaching, and one was the out-of-person church. And this willingness to stand side by side for the good of the city. So that was the original impetus for starting together with Common Good.
And now, can you see parallels between what was happening in Liverpool in the 80s and what's happening in the wider community today, Jenny?
I think we can see parallels. A lot of us who were around during that time can recognise those parallels in terms of people being left behind, poverty, but I actually think it's much more serious now. It's not just some parts of this country, it's right across the Western world. So we're seeing the same kind of divides in all the Western countries, particularly in the UK and America. And I think it's to do with a rise of probably 4 decades of individualism, a kind of cultural influence that's affected our lives together.
What do you think are the key things that we can learn from the partnership?
So the key things that we've drawn from really studying and investigating the partnership and talking to people from you and talking to people who are here. First thing is willing to work with people who are different from us. Willing to work with people who disagree, who have not just a different doctrinal position perhaps, but who come from different backgrounds, who may disagree politically. A willingness to work across our differences. And at the same time, not to try and dilute our own needs. So for example, my father is an evangelical Anglican, a traditional evangelical background. Archbishop Warlock was an of love, deplatforming people that don't agree with, refusing to share, you know, space with somebody. This talk of safe spaces is so unhealthy. You know, we don't want to hear anything that we don't agree with. This is actually very dangerous. Pushes people into silence and makes them more resistant to narratives that are different from their own. So that's the first thing we're looking to cover across our differences. And being confident in our own identity. So as Catholics, being confident that we have a tradition that's really valuable. And also this sense of sharing gifts, that we have different things that we can bring to the table. So not just saying we'll work together when we're different, but what is it that you have that I don't have that we need? So maybe that could be in terms of assets, physical buildings, money, access to movements, but it could be particular personality traits, it could be relationships, connections. We find that when we work with people who are from different backgrounds, it radically enriches what we do. It makes us more effective.
Because it's true to say in certain circumstances, we Catholics, I'm speaking as a Catholic, are very good at actually looking after our own. We don't always extend the same services to the wider community.
That's interesting to see that, because in the biography of Derek Waller, Clifford Longley observed that, and he said that he felt it was something that Archbishop Warlock had learned from my father, which was why the Catholic Church had something online to share with the wider community. That if, yes, there was a sense of almost a siege mentality of ministering to one's own, to making sure the conversation was all right, but not really thinking about outside the walls. So it's this sense of we do have something of real value that can help the rest of society. And so it's meant to be flattening the walls of the church, looking around us, who is around us, who's not currently in our small community.
Now your organisation is called Together for the Common Good, and you have a specific interpretation of the common good, don't you, which is a phrase you recognise is bandied around by politicians, religious leaders, yeah, and various others. Do you want to actually, before we go any further, explain what you understand?
Yeah. I think that's really important, because the common good can be a phrase that people project onto. They make it mean anything they want to mean. And within Catholic teaching, it actually has a very specific definition. And we've worked with it quite intensely for the last 5 years. We've tested it out across different denominations. We've compared it with other understandings of the common good in Aristotle, in Jewish thinking, different Christian traditions, and human traditions. And we think that the Catholic definition, enriched by the other Christian traditions, leads us to say that the common good is the shared life of a society in which every person is able to contribute according to their gifts and abilities, taking responsibility, working together across their differences to create conditions in which everybody flourishes. So that's a slightly richer definition than what the traditional Catholic Church definition, which is it's a set of conditions in which every individual and community can flourish. We think that if we stick with that, it can sound like we're working towards something that exists over there. It's like an abstract, utopian ideal. And I'm emphatically about to say the common good is not a utopian ideal. It's something we create here and now. In fact, all of us gathered here, we are creating a common good because we've come together, and especially when we have our conversation, it's our shared life, it's our connections with each other that really matters. So examples of common good can be, for example, a local book club or a sports club or a gathering, a festival, in which there are different voices that contribute. It doesn't have to be perfect. In fact, it's more likely to be imperfect because it's human. This idea of pursuing and seeking your common good as if it's over there somewhere, I don't use that language because I feel that feels too elusive, and it has a tendency to encourage us to think of utopias. And that's dangerous because that leads to totalitarian thinking. So we're talking about rooted, local, real, human, engaged with shared. But I would say that there are, if we look at, let's look at, say, a soup kitchen. We'd all think immediately that's definitely common good, isn't it? But I would say, look at it a bit more carefully. Are we just serving soup to people who are passively receiving? Or are we inviting them into a shared life? So that's a sort of difference. It's a difference between doing to and working with. So for example, one of our workshops recently, someone had a light bulb moment and precisely on that subject. And she said, right, next time we go back to my planning group, we're going to look at how we can find a role. And this is the sort of shift we're talking about. It's about entering into a shared life, what Pope Francis and Jean Vanier call the culture of encounter.
It reminds me of the big issue that a hand up, not a hand out.
Yes, that the model of the big issue is a good one. I think what's becoming a primary problem in London, it's becoming too established, but the idea of people having to do something for themselves gives them dignity. In fact, we are infantilising people by not requiring anything of them. And that's a real danger for people well-meaning, do-gooding Christians. It is a real danger, and it happens a lot. And I would say that's not strictly common good. You have to, the test is there a sense of them being able to take a role, however modest that might be? Does that make sense?
Yeah. To be fair, it's not easy to do, is it? It's not easy to stretch out to those who are different from us and actually work with them rather than for them. Can you relate that to the Eucharist in terms of the passive, active design?
Well, it's interesting, isn't it? Because the Congress is very much focused on adoration. So I personally enjoy going to adoration. But I think that we need to be thinking about the Eucharist as it's not a private act. It's not a consumerist thing. We're not going there to get something and take it away. When we go to communion, we're not just going to get our communion and then just carry on as we were before. By taking a part of the body of Christ into ourselves, we become carriers of what Christ wanted. And so actually, is it a private act? It takes us out into the world, calls us out to live the way He wanted us to live. And that includes reaching out to others. It includes this sense of shared life. It's not about turning in on ourselves. Obviously there's a sense of, and I feel as I'm sure you do when preparing for communion, you know, I'm not worthy to receive you. That's my favourite part. I find it very moving. We know that we're all imperfect and we're all broken and we can only do so much and we can only do what we do with the help of God and the Holy Spirit. And so that sense of being called into that communal experience, that communion, I find very much that we're all our little parts that we all needed, and kind of without each other, it's an incomplete picture. And so God needs us to participate. So I feel it's a kind of calling to participate.
I don't know how many of you heard Jim McGovern yesterday, his Francis Saviour's Church, talking about the brokenness of our communities. If you watch, like me, the series Broken, then I think that gives a very good illustration of the brokenness of the community, illustrated by the good priests who serve that community. What can the Eucharist tell us about the brokenness?
Well, I think if we convert it, we need to look at our country and our national community as if it were like the body that the whole causes to be. That there are parts of our national community that other parts would rather weren't there. It's neutral. There are different parts of our community that really would rather not ever encounter or talk with or engage with people who disagree with them. The Brexit Remain divide is the most obvious one. And that is a values divide, which is not peculiar to our country. It's
also the States, it's also in other parts of Europe. It's a feature of decades of individualism and the effects of economic and cultural liberalism, which have split us. And people genuinely do feel different. They have different views, they come from different backgrounds, have different experiences, and I think Jesus wept at this division between us, particularly if Christians take a tribal life. I think we are made for something better than that. I think we're called to resist that temptation to demonize the other, to dismiss people because they read a certain newspaper, or because they follow a particular party, or because they take a particular line on Brexit. We're meant to transcend those divisions, we're meant to be bridge builders. I think that's what reconciliation message is about. And if we're carrying a part of the body of Christ, we're becoming a part of that, at that mysterious community. I think it's a real problem if before that moment, when we're doing that in the conscience, if we think, well, I really can't reconcile that view that so and so has. I can't bear it. We've got to work on that in ourselves, because if we allow that kind of tribal instinct, we are contributing to the division. And I think we have to ask ourselves hard questions, you know, how well do we know the people in our congregation? Do people have different views on this? Or are we just pretending? We gather for a cup of tea after Mass and just sort of ignoring the difficult things.
Even within your own community, there can be divisions. I don't know what your own experience is in the audience, but we are culturally different to the two Masses on Sunday. So the people who go to 9 o'clock, the profile, the leaves maybe, the way we demonstrate our faith, and certainly the priest who chooses to say that Mass, we're all different from the people who go to the 9 o'clock. 9 o'clock's messy because there are children there, and historically I suppose people grow up with the same people and attend the same Mass. But the other thing is, in relation to communities, that some of the brokenness and the problems are invisible. We're a fairly university town in the East Midlands, fairly middle class. You have to really look sometimes to see over the bridge of what many other people are experiencing. So it's not always invisible.
It certainly is invisible, because we've all ended up living in bubbles, I suppose. Whether we intended that or not, it's just what happens. So I feel that as Christians, we have a particular calling to deliberately or intentionally look outside our little echo chambers, whether that's deliberately seeking out a conversation with someone we know is from a different background or disagrees, or whether it's choosing to spend longer talking with somebody at the checkout who's from a different background, or whether it's choosing to use social media. You've got to recognize the algorithms in your Facebook page are all driving you into a silo. That's what they do. They don't show you. But let's say, would you like to follow this person from a different viewpoint? They ask you to follow people who think like you. This is very dangerous. So we have to subvert that. We have to be conscious of what's happening and make an effort to, as you say, to look for the people who have been sidelined. Who's not present? Might do a sort of mental community mapping. Think of your church. Think of the different organizations, institutions that you know in your neighborhood or different neighborhoods. Think, are there blind spots here? Who don't we know? Why don't we know them? Would they be welcome in our church? Or are there some things about their sort of backgrounds or their behavior that we don't like? We'd rather that we're part of. What does that say about us as a Eucharistic community? It's a hard thing to ask, and I'm not suggesting that we put ourselves in real discomfort here, but I think that we need to get a sort of mind shift when we start to be conscious about who's not present. It's nearly always the usual suspects, isn't it, who run things, control things. So who's not there? I think we have to be conscious of who's been pushed.
pushed out to the margin because their views and opinions are unpopular, unfashionable. That might include some of us here. Some of us here might feel, well, say my views on euthanasia, for example, are not popular. There's like a general trend now towards assisted dying. We might disagree with that. We might feel sidelined. There are lots of different ways of looking at this. Different topics, people will be sidelined for different reasons.
I imagine because many of our audience are here, because of the Congress, and obviously many of you link with the Justice and Peace movement, I imagine you're not waiting for the church as an institution to give you permission to get involved. But what sort of things do you think as individuals we can do to actually move the agenda forward when it comes to building bridges and helping people, helping the poor?
Well, I think the first thing we can say is to try and have a one-to-one conversation, if possible, every day. It doesn't have to be really long, but with somebody who you don't know, who may well be from a different background or a different opinion. Or try and read something, say, read a newspaper you wouldn't normally read, and read it putting yourself in the shoes of the readers, rather than just dismissing. I think just try to discomfort yourself a little bit, sacrifice that comfort zone. That's one thing. Another thing would be to look at who you're involved in social action, not a lot of people here are. And just do what we were saying earlier, just ask yourself, are we asking something of the people we're serving? Are they included? I'll give you an example. We know this lovely Italian priest who, rather than operating a normal soup kitchen, opened his kitchen, his own kitchen, every day of the week for the last 10 years. It's pretty radical. And not serving people who came in, but they cook together and wash up together. And they create family. These are people who were ex-offenders, homeless, broken families, broken relationships, messed up a bit in the past, lost what it's like to be, how to behave, how to have a conversation around the team. And through, we've almost ministered to each other over that time. That's a, I think, a wonderful example of the shift from doing to working with, to building a common good. There are lots of other things that we can do that are perhaps less challenging personally. So, for example, if you have a pension, is it invested ethically? Is it invested in such a way that you're supporting financial inclusion, or are you part of the problem? This is the sort of thing that is possible for us all to do. I know a lot of you do live simply and you build all that into your life. That's really important as well. The key thing is about relationships. So if any of you are in a workplace, for example, has a Christmas party, ask yourself, do they invite the cleaners? Cleaners invited to the party? Usually. Why is that? Perhaps some of you, a number of people in the older generation here, perhaps have children or grandchildren who are in the workplace. Maybe ask them that question. Does the CEO know the lowest paid staff? Are there any opportunities for actually mixing? You notice that I'm not pushing in the political realm here, because I think other people do that well, and that's not our main focus. We're not saying it's in struggle, we're saying it's both out. But we're saying that we personally can do a great deal that we're not already doing, that gradually will change the culture. And the culture will only change bottom up. We can only expect government to do so much. But the shift we're needing is so serious, so deep. It has to come from the bottom up.
Your father's quoted in the book as saying, we're called to change the course of events. What he wasn't referring to then was political action. It was relationships, people getting together to move things forward.
Example here in Liverpool, he and Derek Warlock were approached by a group of people who had been were threatened with being moved when the slum clearance was taking place, being dispersed as a community, broken up and sent out to outer estates and new flats. And they wanted to change the course of events. He said, no, we we don't want to just be packed up wherever and our long-standing communities have been broken up. We've spotted a piece of land over there where the Tate and Mile Capital used to be, and we want to build a village. We want to live there. We want our families to grow up there. And they went to the council, which was at the time. They wouldn't tell them because they said, I know all social housing must be provided for by the state, not by you. So they persisted and they went to their local priest, and he eventually got the bishops involved. Anyway, cut a long story short, they built that village. It's a community housing association. And it's still there now, it's one of the walls, it's called the Aldonians Housing Association. It's not very far from here. And 150 families moved in, and their successes continue to live there. But that's an example of changing course of events. And yes, it evolves in conversations and negotiations and arguments with politicians. Ironically, it's actually the Thatcher government that enabled the banning to take place, which has been blocked by the militants. But the point is, it was led by the independent people. And the bishops didn't take over, they just helped enough, not in a patrician way, but they just helped enough in order that things could happen. It took years. That's the sort of intervention that the church can make that will change the course of events. I think it needs to be constructive, positive, not always angry. If there is a case for protest, there is a case for arguing against injustice, but I think that we're going to be much more effective and we would like to get more people involved, particularly young people, if it's constructive.
You are very much carrying on your father's legacy, but not just in Liverpool, nationally. Can you describe the work that you do and give an example, a couple of examples, of projects which meet the criteria you've been describing to us?
Yeah, so we've done various things over the last few years. What we're doing now is we're just about to launch some training workshops in problem-based thinking for lay people, for church leaders and for teachers. And so one example is we just started a pilot in the school we're using our common good resources for key stages 3 and 4, so we're doing from 11 to 16. What we're encouraging them to do by our whole series of interventions of some of these lessons and community engagement activities is to help the school see itself as an outward facing institution. In the same way I say about the church, flattening the walls, imagining who's in the community, who can be part of it. So we're encouraging them to build relationships with other local institutions and also to teach the children the principles of common good thinking, which is broadly speaking Catholic social teaching.
This relates very well. I don't know whether any of you heard Rabbi Jonathan Sacks in his Radio 4 programmes on morality this week, Saturday, yes. Because he was engaging with young people and asking them to talk about their vision for the future and their version of what morality means. So that works very well.
I think one of the things that came through, and it's a brilliant set of programs by the way, if you haven't heard it, I would highly recommend you go to our iPlayer. It's about 15 different podcasts that you can listen to. He is really talking about the common good. I think it's been titled Morality, but actually for me the whole series is about the common good. But one of the things that came through for me is that young people today are looking for meaning. They're looking for purpose. And we're in an age of nihilism. We're in an age of where people are saying, well, nothing that anybody does matters. If everything's fine, it's a cultural relativism. Doesn't really matter. If you're not people saying, well, what difference will it make? So the message we have given instead is everything you do matters. Every decision you make is really important. Take responsibility. And that's actually resonating. And he found that too. Young people actually prefer to be seen as potentially capable people rather than passive consumers of entertainment from Hollywood or people who just slot into a group identity lifestyle. They're individuals with talents, competence and ability and vocation. We use the language of vocation for ordinary people, not just for the priesthood or religious orders. We think that every one of us has a vocation and a calling according to our possibility. We think that helping young people when they're young to see that. What's the purpose, after all, of doing maths GCSE? What's the purpose when it's so boring? What, you know, it fits in because if you're going to be a person who makes a contribution and has meaning in your life, this will give you skills and abilities that make sense. So I think that's part of what he was talking about, this sense of what can we do to counteract this culture of nihilism which is infecting the West. And sadly, we're seeing rising numbers of suicide, loneliness. The statistics actually show that young people from 16 to 24 are more lonely than old people now. And this is coming from this kind of individualism culture and from accelerated by social media. So we have work to do. We have to encourage the relational, encourage conversation, set up context where people can meet each other for real, face to face, not just virtually. So for young people, it's a terrible thing that youth centres and youth work has been so decimated. I heard a great story yesterday about a parish down south. It's actually a sad story because it's no longer happening, but the parishioners got together and said, we want to have a youth centre. We want to pay for a youth worker because we can see the need for that. And they raised the money themselves. And the priest said, fine, off you go, do it. Enable the layers to lead. And they had this wonderful, a few years of this, and then sadly, a new priest came and stopped it. But why not? Any parish could do that. I know one of the things people often say is, how do we get young people involved? Well, they're not going to get involved in our stuff because we're old. They don't, it doesn't resonate with them. They need to be involved in something that they have created, that space is for them. And we need to be willing to take on that cultural challenge that may come from them and start to help them to set the agenda.
I know that you're conscious, Jenny, that we haven't got monopoly on good ideas. It would be really good to hear something from the audience. So at this point, we're going to pause for 2 or 3 minutes and to ask you to give some examples from your own parishes, your own communities, of what you are doing to inspire the rest of us to further the common good, particularly in relation to reconciliation. And at the same time, consider whether you have any questions for Jenny. So 2 or 3 minutes now.
Hello. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Mark. I'm an animator for the Global Catholic Climate Movement. And I also work at CAFOR and I also work at Project Chairman Schools. And reconciliation with what we're doing, the damage that we're doing to the climate. And it's about waste, recycling, awareness, Project for Schools. And with this being season of creation, we've got an opportunity to focus on that, and everywhere we look, it is on the news today. We've got also, to coincide with season of creation, the launch of the film on global healing, which is from the Bishop's Conference. And that is a very, very relevant film for us today. We need to really try to engage our parishes in watching this and creating an opportunity for everybody to come together and just understand what's happening. And you are messengers, really. But we've got it on in the lounge. We've got some soup, and I've also got my eco brick project PowerPoint as well. In addition to that, there's a little bit about what CAFOR are doing. Parishes, and there's also a demonstration of the bog boxes, which is once again about the climate, that's a back for the blue box, which you want to demonstrate. It's nice and power, but
right. Okay, I'm fascinated to know how you create an eco brick out of a plastic bottle or a few plastic bottles, but no doubt we'll find out later. Thank you, Bob. Would anybody else like to give us an example? Please do. Writing.
I've just been very impressed with the way Wigan Council has dealt with all of the local government cuts. So they decided to do everything in an asset-based approach. So they've done this deal for communities, and they made £7 million available for people to apply to for a community investment fund. I'm just very impressed with them. They're doing a really good job. I work in Wigan for a charity that supports asylum seekers and refugees, and they've given us a community centre for 5 years. We paid £10 a year. They just gave it away. They couldn't look after it. They're giving it to us. We've got this massive arts venue. It's a different charity. They've given this old courts to them, and this is this thriving, biggest per square metre arts venue in Europe. But they're just doing great.
Is that as a result of successful lobbying by your own organisation and others?
I think that's a great example. It's giving things back to people to run themselves, rather than the sense of being recipients from what the state decides is good for people. So that's a great example. Does anyone else like to say something?
Like some people here, I went to the showing of Broken yesterday. And it struck me that is such a potentially wonderful resource for reaching out. If it was shown in as many parishes as possible, and it was unfortunate that there weren't DVDs available yesterday, it strikes me that it's something that can be watched and discussed by clergy and laity alike, and laity with different views as well, and provides almost a space where issues could be raised instead of what I always think of as the concentric circles of clergy speaking to each other and laity speaking to each other. And there being so few opportunities to actually come together and talk very openly and on an equal level.
Jay Cunningham from St. Albans Parish in Preston. We assist in a drop-in centre on Tuesday night. It's run by another church, an ecumenical church called Love Preston, LUB, and they use our premises to run the soup kitchen. There are more and more of us involved in helping them, and as well as the soup kitchen, we have food donated by various businesses in the town, which is snapped up by between 60 and 80 users. But I was very touched by two things. One, the fact that we're involved with other churches. There are people, Catholics, Christians, and no faith at all who come and join us. There's also, took on board what Jenny was saying earlier about not simply giving people something, but actually getting them involved so that we're all working together. That is something I hope to impact.
Sometimes the language isn't helpful, is it? They call people users. You know, it says it's on what it says on the tin, isn't it? It doesn't give them any other role to play. Anybody else?
At the risk of offending the ladies here present, in our parish, for a number of years we've had links with the Anglican parish down the road, and just recently we've established a man's den where the minority and other men in our parish, we meet in the crypt of the Anglican church, and on a Saturday morning, in fact, I should be there now. And it's early days, but we're in another way that you can be sitting in the bench with somebody for years and years and years, and you never know their opinions on anything because you exchange a sign of peace with them, and that's about all you do. So it's early days, but there are signs that we're breaking down barriers, not only with people in our own parish, but people in neighbouring parishes and so on. So early days, but I think there's going to be a fruitful project.
Thank you.
think that sounds really good because sometimes the hidden can include men. In fact, men are more at risk of suicide than women, and loneliness, so they tend to have not such strong social networks, and when things are wrong, they don't talk. So when we're talking earlier about who is in the sideline or who is silenced or hidden in the community, that could involve men. We have a lot of talk these days about women's rights and focus on women and so on, but actually there's a lot of evidence to show that the group that's struggling most is young men. So I think it's about being alert to who is silenced. Who else would like to say?
And I'm imagining being here in Cardiff. Just in my parish, well, with one of the local mosques, that might be true of the local mosques, had a silent refugee project, bringing across a Syrian refugee family. This involved a lot of money raising and meeting the requirements of the government in the hope of this has been approved and over the Arabic that's going ahead now. And hopefully this family will arrive. We had one fundraiser at one of the mosques, and it was sad in the way, but not many from the Catholic from our parish turned up. The parish priest went, Sister Ruth O'Neill, who runs the Silence of the Drop-in Centre, and I think three or four of the rest of us, and we sort of helped raise money. The what interesting was that our parish priest gave a little talk, Sister Ruth gave a little talk, the Muslim woman who seemed to be in charge gave a little talk. None of the Muslim men spoke. I just wondered whether there was something there. What I'm thinking now is that the hope is that the Syrian family will arrive in October or so. And from what you're saying about doing something with them and sharing, if we can get a perhaps, I might, we could talk about getting them, what they can give us, instead of just being recipients of our charity. They can become active in the Muslim and Christian group that have done this.
Really good to hear that. And also another thing that we like to draw attention to is there are a lot of parishes who are doing either community sponsorship or helping out with refugees in some way or another. Sometimes, I mean that's really great and we want that to happen, but sometimes helping out refugees or helping people overseas can be a way of overlooking people who are right on the doorstep. So I think every time we think of helping refugees, helping people in Syria and so on, try and get train your brain to think, and what about the people right next door? So it's both and, it's not either or.
My example was exactly what you were talking about, but slightly different. A couple of people in our parish in Clitheroe in Lancashire started a project up called Refugee Dine With Me. It's based on the TV series, but basically they set about getting 20 families in the parish to invite 20 people, refugee families that they'd never met in their life or anything like that, to come together and share a meal, and just in the simple, normal thing of having a meal, sort of start breaking down those sort of barriers of ignorance, etc. It's a lovely idea, but just to take it on a little bit further from what you were just saying there, Jenny, which I think you're quite right on, is that I think our next project is to take that model and make it much more local to, your neighbour come dine with me, which is, in particular in our case, looking at older people in the community that we're with, and just inviting somebody, an older person that's perhaps in a care home or has been widowed or etc., just to come and have a meal and just have the normal, ordinary things that people miss through being alone, so to speak. And so that might be our next project inspired by the conversation here. Thank you.
Yeah, I know of a vicar, just to say one thing. A vicar who is in a parish church just not very far from here, who did a similar thing, but he opened his front room every Monday night just for people in the neighbourhood, just to come and eat together. So it didn't have to be an ex-offender, it didn't have to be homeless. It's a bit like that, isn't it? If you're black, gay and unemployed, you come in, but if you're not, you're not welcome. We mustn't get to that point, we must be like everybody. And not make it sound like you're a bit of a loser. do. So, it's a, that's actually a real danger. If we are going to have shared meals, make sure it is genuinely a mixture.
Sorry, my name's Annie. I'm not from a particular parish, but for the last 14 years I've been working with an organisation called Faiths for Change, which was set up in Liverpool originally by the former Bishop of Liverpool, James Jones, along with Monsignor John Devine and other faith leaders. Quite recently, over the last 3 years, we've been working with St. Leonard's in Bootle, which is the kind of hub for the South Sefton food banks. And partly through funding, we have worked with people that have come through the food banks as a kind of connection. We've been working with them to teach and share cooking and nutrition skills by making a meal and sharing a meal together each week. And so we worked with 12 people in the last year, and at the end of the 6 weeks of working together, 8 of those 12 people said, we want to carry on. It's coming up to Christmas. We know there are people in the community that may be using the food bank, may not be using the food bank, they're hungry. Many living in bed sits, a lot of older men or people with mental health problems. And so we listened, and the people that run St. Leonard's listened, including the people from the church. And so we worked together, and they invited people locally, including people they just met on the street, and we supported those 8 people to cook a meal for 30 odd people. And as a result of that, they felt really kind of encouraged, and they grew in confidence themselves, and they carried that on. And in the new year, sort of early part of this year, ran with just a little bit of support for us, a weekly lunch. 4 people, and again opened the doors, invited people to come in, but we did it in a really good quality way. So we did use food that had been fresh been donated from the supermarkets, but because we trained people, they also did their food safety qualification and nutrition qualification, so actually it was proper good quality nutritional food, but served in kind of restaurant style. So we worked as volunteers, as kind of not just to cook, but to wait, so that people coming in, people that St. Leonard had really tried hard to get in over the years and struggled with, actually felt really special. And the feedback that we received from that was really good. 4 of those original people that came from the cooking course then ran this summer with other local parents. Had a programme over the summer, not just to feed people that were struggling to feed their children over the summer, but also to put on an arts programme as well. So that work's continued from an original small investment in those people, and they themselves work very locally to keep things happening.
Thank you very much. I think we have to wind up now. I'll hand it back to Catherine. I think the simple thing is that when we next go to Mass, when we have that moment that parents got for communion, I'm not worthy to receive you, but only a safe word and my son shall be healed. If we can just pause for a moment now and just think about that moment and think, am I guilty of being tribal? Have I stereotyped somebody because I think they think that and therefore they're not on my side? Do I hold views about people from different backgrounds? I think if we tie that into our experience of the Eucharist, it will remind us that we are part of the body of Christ, and it's our calling to go out into the world and to build bridges with people in all kinds of different ways that's appropriate to our own gifts and abilities. Just before we wrap up, this little booklet that
that we've prepared. It's for sale over there. It's only £4 a copy. It's a Bible study, 6 chapters, scripture, questions, reflection, items for discussion. It's perfect for your prayer group, social action team meeting, away day, retreats. It's been used by dioceses across the country. It's been written specifically for Christians of all denominations, and particularly if you want to meet with other Christians of different traditions. So, for example, if you're involved with a food bank or a homeless shelter, you work with Christians of other traditions, you could suggest that you meet together and use this booklet to pray together, to review your work together. It also includes at the back what we call common good thinking, which is essentially Catholic social teaching, but simplified and made easy for people to access, and in a language that works and resonates with Christians of all traditions. So come and have a look over there. It's only £4 a copy. We don't make any profit. It's an honesty box. Please sign up for our newsletter, which comes out about every 8 weeks or so. We won't bombard you very often. Join about 2,000 other people who receive our newsletter across the UK and abroad. And do take a this card and have a look at our website.
Thank you.